All right, thank you for joining us today. I'm Flagler County Sheriff Rick Staley. I'm joined today with LaShaka Moore, our school superintendent and school board chair, Will Furry. We want to address the series of calls making threats directed toward our schools. First, let me say that we are only doing this in response to concerns and rumors about these threats, many on social media that frankly are inaccurate information. So we're hoping to set the record straight about what is occurring and what we are doing today. But this will be our only press conference on this matter until an arrest is made, because we don't want to feed this caller's sick ego. On Tuesday, May 14th at around 2:50 p.m., the Sheriff's Communications Center received a call where the caller threatened to shoot up Buddy Taylor Middle School. The school had already been released from students for the day. And that's an indicator to us that the caller maybe didn't really know much about Buddy Taylor Middle School. But not taking any chances, 24 units from the Sheriff's Office responded, and we searched Buddy Taylor Middle School, and because on the same campus area is Wadsworth Elementary, we also checked that school, and which was still in session. It had been put in a lockdown status while the school was searched. And then after the all call was clear was given, then normal student pickup procedures resumed. The following morning at about 7 a.m., an anonymous call was made to the Sheriff's Communications Center with a similar shooting threat against Buddy Taylor Middle School. 22 units responded and determined that threat to be unfounded. However, it did disrupt the bus transportation, which was diverted and eventually was allowed to come back. Then that same day in the afternoon at 2:45 p.m., our dispatch received another call. This time the caller said that they would shoot every police officer that responded and that they had placed two bombs inside Old Kings Elementary. This time 19 patrol units responded. Also at 3:10 p.m., our dispatch received another call and a call from the Lincoln, Nebraska Police Department, who had received an anonymous call that contained threats of both a shooting and two bombs at Buddy Taylor Middle School. And I want to thank the Lincoln, Nebraska Police Department for finding out where the school was and then calling us, which is what we would do if the roles were reversed. At 3:17 p.m., the Volusia County Sheriff's Office received a call saying two pipe bombs had either been placed at First Baptist Christian Academy or Suncoast Community School in Bunnell. At that time, seven units responded, five from the Sheriff's Office and two from the Bunnell Police Department. So you can see we had a lot of activity going on with multiple units responding, basically everybody that was on duty. And finally, this morning at about 6:50 a.m., the Volusia County Sheriff's Office received a call which threatened a shooting and placing of bombs at Buddy Taylor Middle School, and 12 units responded. In every incident, sheriff's deputies swiftly responded in full force and searched thoroughly until no threats were found and everything was clear, including using our explosive detection canine. During these situations, we continue to maintain a presence at all other Flagler schools. We conducted proactive patrols to ease parents, kids, and faculty concerns. We are investigating these series of threats, which is occurring nationwide, hoaxes called swatting. That's a term that refers to calls that are falsely report an act of violence in progress or about to occur. They are intended to set off a massive and immediate deployment of armed law enforcement to a specific location, including SWAT teams. We are working with the FBI, FDLE, and our Homeland Security section is actively pursuing all leads, and frankly, we're out until midnight last night following leads and conducting the investigation. This year in our state alone, swatting calls have been made to Bay County, Brevard County, Duval County, Escambia County, and Miami-Dade County. Nationwide, swatting calls have been received from Las Vegas to Nebraska, targeting everyone from political officials to college campuses. These calls can be made from someone local to someone outside of the United States and anywhere in between, which makes it difficult to trace, but we are actively pursuing all leads in this investigation. We are working with Flagler County Schools to ensure parents are informed of lockdowns in a timely manner when these threats occur. It is imperative that parents and guardians follow instructions on pickup and drop-off procedures in the event of a threat or a lockdown. I want to commend our school resource deputies, our community policing division, our canine units, our PACE unit, our communications, our real-time crime center, essentially our entire team, for their swift and thorough response to ensure the safety of our schools. At this time, it's imperative to combat disinformation. In fact, I saw some of the comments on Facebook when we announced a lockdown or large police presence. I heard they found a gun. No gun was found. No bomb has been found. No suspicious package has been found. But they are getting what they're trying to accomplish, a large response from law enforcement. I would encourage you, if you're a parent, look at your kid's phone. And if you see unusual phone calls being made, like to Nebraska, or to numbers you don't recognize, you might want to ask your child about that, just in case. And that would help us potentially. I want to ensure the parents, the grandparents, and all residents of Flagler County that until an arrest is made and the threat stops, we will continue to treat each threat as if it's real and will respond accordingly. And this is a very dangerous response. When you think you can have 22 patrol units responding, blue lights and siren in traffic, it's dangerous for our deputies, it's dangerous for the community in this response. And that's why we're gonna do everything we can to try to find this individual and arrest them. And each call that they make is a felony by itself. So they've racked up about 8 felonies right now. And we're going to do everything we can to charge them. Each one of those is a third-degree felony. I would ask that if anyone is listening or watching online right now or listening to your reports, if they have information on who potentially this caller is, submit a tip to us. You can go use our phone app and submit anonymously or call Crime Stoppers in Northeast Florida at 1-888-277-TIPS. If you call through that line, you could receive a reward. We will continue to investigate this matter, and we will do our best to find this perpetrator and hold that individual accountable. So I'm going to turn it over to the school board chairman for his comments, and then LaShaka Moore, superintendent, and then we'll open it up for any questions that you may have.
Will. Thank you, Sheriff. Good afternoon, Flagler families. My name is Will Furry. I'm the chair of the Flagler County School Board. I just want to assure you that the safety and security of your children is our highest priority. After we received word of these threats, Superintendent Moore put our safety protocols into place immediately, paving the way for the sheriff to search our schools. I want to thank Sheriff Staley and the school resource deputies for your fast response and in the search of our schools to ultimately invalidate these threats so we could return to a regular school day. I also want to thank Superintendent Moore for herself and her team, who swiftly sprung into action, notifying all of our district schools to be on high alert, also briefing the board and myself regularly, and also, most importantly, making sure that our students were in out of harm's way. And once we had the all clear, that they were returned to campus safely or reunited with their parents. Also, finally, I have a message to the perpetrator making these threats. Stop it now. Whatever you're trying to accomplish here in Flagler County, I can assure you it will fall flat. I cannot think of a more cowardly thing to do than to target children or instill fear in their hearts. I can assure you that you will not affect our children, our parents, or our staff. We are a community that is of courage and resiliency, and I am confident that you will be found and you will be brought to justice. I'm now going to turn this over to Superintendent Moore to say a few words.
Thank you, LaShaka Moore, Superintendent Flagler Schools. Thank you, Sheriff Saley, for providing the details. My message really is to our families to say that we know that this has been a very difficult week, but in these moments, our first priority is ensuring that our students, our faculty, and our staff, that they are all safe and that we can return your children home to you safely. And so we, too, have received a lot of feedback on communication being timely. But in those moments, the first thing that we have to do is ensure that our students, our faculty, and our staff, they are safe. And we will continue to work to ensure that our family and our community are well prepared and well knowledgeable around what is happening. Again, I do thank Sheriff Saley. I thank our entire sheriff's office and their team, as well as our faculty and our staff, for all that they've done. And I will say that we plan to have a normal, we're not making any changes to our rest of our school year. We only have a few days left. Normal school practices will continue to happen across Flagler schools. And we thank you, and we'll answer any questions that you may have. It's definitely not something you want to start your day with or end or have at all. But I just want to acknowledge our faculty and our staff from our schools. This is something that has impacted and disrupted school across our district, but our staff, they have responded extremely well. I'm very pleased with their response. Our students have done a phenomenal job of responding. Each month they have drills, and they were very responsive, going immediately into our safety protocol. And so I'm thankful to our staff. I'm thankful for our students who take this seriously. And again, I'm with Sheriff Staley that, you know, I'm confident that you're gonna find them. And who they are, we'll get a chance to see and maybe get a picture into why they would want to disrupt school in this way.
There was a statement put out by Flagler Schools 42 minutes ago that said, in part, for the rest of the school year, we will continue our normal operations and increase law enforcement presence on all campuses. This isn't for anyone in particular, but to clarify, that doesn't signify there's gonna be any change in how the sheriff's office and the district have been responding to these first few incidents, right?
So I can't put 22 deputies at each school like we've had to respond. What I can tell you is that since the Stoneman Douglas incident 6 years ago, the district and I have worked closely together. There's been huge improvements on the hardening of our schools across the district. Deputies are all equipped with AR-15s. And we go through significant training. They also know my expectations that we immediately go in and we immediately stop the threat if it's a legitimate call. And besides just hardening, the school district now has better technology. And I'm not going to go into all of those details because I don't want people to know what the technology is and exactly how it works, but it allows virtually immediate communication to the sheriff's office. Our real-time crime center has access to all of the school district's cameras, and if a threat is identified, we have the ability to instantly pull it up and so that we are giving real-time information to responding deputies. So a lot of, there's been huge increases in security since Stoneman Douglas in our district.
Sheriff, while you're up there, do you feel like it's the same caller?
So I have listened to every call, and I'm not going to speculate on whether it is or isn't, but we do have some indicators from these calls. And let me just leave it at that because it's an active investigation. My biggest concern with even doing this press conference is it creates copycats. And so my warning to anyone that thinks that they can be a copycat is we're going to come after your ass too if you do it. And you guys probably have to bleep that. But, you know, every time we get a call like this, it's a third degree felony. And we're going to put resources in there to catch you. And once in a while, we get lucky on these kind of swatting calls. We identified one that came out of Virginia a year or so ago and was assisted in that case. So what motivates these people? Who knows? There's chat rooms where, you know, I did this today, and, you know, now this other group has to try to top it. So, and there's software out there that helps people to commit these crimes. And but that, unfortunately, is the technology world that we live in today.
Lincoln, Nebraska?
Well, I listened to that call, too, and they were surprised that they got a call, and they tracked it down to Palm Coast, the location of the caller. I'm not saying the call was made from Palm Coast, but unfortunately, they called us to let us know what they had.
But why would they call Lincoln?
Well, if I could share that call with you, dispatchers in Lincoln, Nebraska, and dispatchers here were trying to wonder that too, based on the conversation. But who knows?
Would you be willing to release the call so that maybe the public can
get
clues on the voices?
We thought about that, and I made the decision not to because I don't want to hamper the investigation at this point. Well, what I can tell you is that historically, when arrests are made, they're somewhere usually between the age of 16 and 24. And so that's the closest I'm going to get you to an age. But, you know, again, I don't want to compromise. Our people are working around the clock, basically. And these are not easy investigations because many times they use technology to spoof a phone number, if you will, and there's lots of things that they can do to try to disguise who they are. But we have capability, so does FDLE, so does the FBI, that can usually, eventually, get through all the roadblocks that they put out there. Correct. So fortunately, people have been killed by mistakes because they're not expecting a big response from law enforcement, and they make a fugitive move that a law enforcement officer may perceive, or maybe it's 3 o'clock in the morning and it's a swatting call at a home and nobody expects to get woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning and come to the door with a gun. So those things can happen. That's why our deputies are so well trained, and usually there's enough indicators that it's a swatting type call that we respond accordingly. You do it at a school, though, you know, we're gonna respond with everything we have till we prove otherwise.
Scott, can you explain the difference between the lockdown that took place in a couple of the schools yesterday? Or searches or anything stepped up beyond what's in place now?
So a few things. One, on our website, flaglerschools.com, you can go and see the definition to all of those safety protocols. In short, when we are in a full lockdown, everyone is in place and not moving about. And then secure hold is a little step down from that. But all of the specifics of that can be found on our website. Yearly, as well as multiple times a year, we work with the sheriff's office. They walk our schools extensively and provide recommendations to us on ways that we can improve safety on our campuses. Of course, after this, we will also debrief and get input from Sheriff Staley and his team on ways that we can improve, and we'll take all of those things into consideration and implement all that we can. You know, I always say parents have to make the decision that is best for them. As an educator, as the superintendent, I will tell you, I say bring your child to school. We're going to have a normal rest of the year, lots of fun activities planned for our students. But it's the parents' right to decide. What we have done is we have excused, and we will continue to excuse absences for families who decide to keep their child at home. And that is their right, and we want to respect that. They have to make the decision that is best for them. But as superintendent, I am confident in our partnership with the sheriff's office, and I say send them to school.
With that being said, looking at with those comments in light, if there's a parent within our district that says, I don't feel comfortable sending my kid to school at all until they catch this perpetrator, are those absences from that student going to be treated any differently than just regular old truancy?
Well, right now we have, what is today's Thursday, so we have 6 days left in school, two of which will be half days of school. So this time of year will be, it is looked at differently, is treated differently. So I don't want to send a blanket message that would apply to all times. But in this event right now, if families are electing to keep their child at home, we are excusing those absences. As the sheriff stated, this has caused a major disruption on our campus. It stops and halters learning on the campuses, because when we're in a lockdown, we're not up teaching. Our students, our faculty, our staff, they are in the safest places within our schools, awaiting for our sheriff's office to come and tell us it is clear for us to remain in our day. The disruption that happened on yesterday caused us to take 25 buses of students from Buddy Taylor to Indian Trails Middle School. So now you're disrupting another school. So it's not just, you know, if it was a joke or a prank or whatever the case may be, it's not funny. Not at all, because it does cause a disruption, but it also causes people to be fearful of what is happening. It disrupts the rest of the organization, because again, we are on high alert, and so some things will change within the safety of our schools at all of our campuses, but it causes a major disruption on our campus.
Have you had an update in faculty absenteeism?
I do not have that that data available, but we will definitely look into that.
Let me just add that I've watched some of the body cam that our deputies, as they're searching the schools, not only are the deputies being very tactical and secure, but I've noticed that the faculty that wants to protect those kids are doing exactly what they're supposed to do. And we learned a lot from Stoneman Douglas, and I personally toured Building 12 about 3 or 4 months ago. We both did, actually. And
Chair Furry as well.
Right.
Yeah, three of us.
And so there were a lot of lessons that have been learned and have been implemented, and I saw that personally as I watched the body cam. So that's good. The other thing that I want to mention is, you know, we focused on the caller and third degree felony. Well, if that person is under age 18, parents, you're going to pay for it. Florida law allows us to charge and seek reimbursement, and you're responsible for your kid. And so if this person is a juvenile living in your house under the age of 18, at 18 they own it, but until then, you own it. You're responsible.
Could you guess the cost?
I don't have it yet. I mean, we're tracking it, but I would say we're probably $8,000 to $10,000 right now, just in our agency alone. And on a couple of these calls, we had fire department staging too. So you got costs from fire rescue also, because you just don't know.
And what happens to your agency when you get this call? How does this disrupt you guys?
Well, we start, obviously it's a priority call. So unless there's another priority call that comes in, calls start stacking up. And you know, concerning to the deputies responding, because you don't know what you're going to walk into, but yet you've taken an oath to go through that door and to protect this community, and in this case, the kids. So obviously, their adrenaline's up and stresses are up. Communication center is busy. The real-time crime center is busy. Our Homeland Security section, our detectives. So it impacts everybody, and everything else gets put on hold. So what they may have been doing, unless there's a priority call, is going to wait until we clear this call and deputies can respond.
Has any physical evidence been collected, or anything beyond just the recordings of phone calls?
I guess what I would say to that is we do have some evidence, but it wouldn't be your traditional evidence. Let me leave it that way.
Is there anything else you can say to what that means?
No. I got the investigators back there looking at me like, don't give away our leads, right? So I got one going back there, you know, like this. So, you know, I don't want to compromise the investigation.
And also a sort of a specific question you may also not be able to answer, but these calls, was anything done like to try and mask the voice of the caller, or was it just a plain spoken voice, as best you could tell?
Yeah, so I'm not going to go into that. We do have some information on that, but I'm not going to release it. No, I think you covered it well. We thank you for coming.
I have one for you too. But when they call, they're talking about bombs. I mean, like, what's their MO? What are they saying?
Well, in a couple cases, they're giving us specific locations. They could just be making that up. You know, all schools have certain things. They got classrooms, they got libraries, they got cafeterias. So, you know, they have auditoriums and many places, gyms, so they can just be making stuff up as our dispatchers are asking questions. So you don't know that, but you know, sometimes they're not saying anything specific other than the school itself, and that that they will shoot any responding law enforcement officer. You know, it's a combination.
So when swatting occurs, like the two effects are the place that the swatting happened to gets a massive headache and confusion from the response, but also however many units, 22 units were called, they were called away from somewhere else in the community, presumably. Is there any indication at this time that that factor, them being called away from other places, may have anything to do with the perpetrator's motive?
No, we have no indications that was a deploy to commit another crime somewhere else, trying to tie sources up. Although, you know, in my career that has been done, but there's no indication that it was done in this case.
Sir, I had a question for you. Step up to the mic there. Boy,
all right,
you looked everyone straight in the eye, and you sound like a man who's mad as heck, and you're not going to take it anymore.
Well,
I mean, you called whoever does this, or whoever, plural, cowards.
Yes, they are cowards. And actually, after walking through the massacre scene of the Marjorie Stoneman Douglas building, what I learned there is that every second matters, right? So we are unwavering when it comes to safety and security. So we will always respond from the district with our security protocols. And with our partnership with the sheriff, we're confident that we will always respond to these matters as we need to. But remember, these folks only have to be right once. We have to be right every time.
And what I would add to that, because it does take the entire team, and that includes the community, to keep our schools safe. So if you hear something, you see something, you need to report it under our see something, say something protocol. Call the non-emergency number, send us a tip. And for the students that are in school and the faculties that are in the school, no one knows that school better than the people working in that school. And if you see something out of place, if you're a student, report it to a teacher, report it to the dean, the principal, so that we know about it. Or same thing, if the faculty sees something that's out of place, let us know so that we can respond appropriately. Okay. All right.
Thank you very much.
Last question.
There's an article, I believe, on the School Resource Deputy Association website that the way to minimize hoaxes, perhaps, would be to minimize as many disruptions as possible. How can you balance that to minimize disruptions in the school day?
Well, I don't know if that's my question or the superintendent's, but here's what I will tell you. You know, when I was in school, that was just a few years ago, okay, what usually happened towards the end of the year or the major test times, a fire alarm would get pulled, right? But now it has evolved into what we're dealing with today, which is a really sad commentary on the American culture, quite frankly. That probably didn't answer your question, but I'll let the superintendent take a stab at it.
And this is what I will add. Again, we will follow our safety protocol. We will follow the lead of the sheriff's office when it comes to the safety of our schools. But we're not going to just put our kids in a room and not do the things that we have planned to do because someone is making these types of calls. If we need to invoke one of our protocols, we'll do that. But outside of that, we're going to have a normal day for our students. This is the end of the year. We have field day and graduation and so many other things happening, and we're going to continue to do that. And if we need to go into a safety protocol, that's what we'll do. But until then, we're going to have a normal day for our students.
Okay, thank you guys.
Thank you.